to make believe work. Actually, that is the time of get out of the sun, you will become black. Both gora tha and red hair up to the age of 7. And dreams, ambitions. I think everybody has, and that's the lovely part of childhood. It's a make-believe world. Aajkal ek slogan hai, make, create, innovate. Ye to pakka hai bache ke bare mein. And when you move around with kids, that's what you experience all of the time. They're making it up, they're creating it, they're innovating it.
And then they're believing it.
And living it.
Living it.
And becoming it.
Yes.
And it's as we go further and further away from those very original ways of being, whether it's upbringing, education, religion, all of those things that batter the soul, you lose that wonderful quality, that spontaneity of childhood. I've often thought that it's amazing how much one remembers. How much we remember. That's why it's always very dangerous when people speak in front of children, fight in front of children, do all kinds of things in front of children, thinking they know nothing. But I think science also proves this. And everybody has their own experience of remembering and getting surprised. How did I remember that? You know, but you obviously remembered it, and then you work it back. You see, I'm only 1.5 years old or something like that, and it has made a strong enough impression to last you all your life. So when you want to talk about childhood, I think it's everybody's childhood, and living in a place like India, so many millions and billions of children without apparent opportunity, and there isn't opportunity for them. But that doesn't stop them being all of who they are, very real, dynamic, fantastic, innovate, create, whatever, you know. The reality of around one, and making it up is what I was talking about, which is not a fantasy world. And what is wrong with a fantasy world? A child has what other than took freedom?
Yes.
But it's based on, I think, my experience and belief, the reality around, as one could interpret it, the non-reality part was throwbacks to maybe what you hear, maybe not understand, but you hear it and you piece it together.
And sometimes you make sense after 5 years, 10 years. Okay, this is what it means, but yeah, I heard in childhood.
Absolutely, and that is why I say be careful of what you say, do, or behave in front of children with the belief that they're not catching it. They don't miss much. They make some interpretation of it. They react somehow to it. Right or wrong, I think right always for that individual, it is right. So to me, growing up in such a large family, I was a terrible introvert way up into my teens. I was more introverted. I wanted people to come to me. I wasn't an outgoing person to run around and make friends and things. I was very happy hitting a tennis ball against a wall, walking around and checking things out myself. Certainly moving myself far away from the house if there was any kind of discord. Climb up into the mulberry tree, and if there were mulberries on the tree, even better.
All the better.
But get out, you know, wherever there was whatever was going on. Being sort of way down the list of children. They were older brothers who were in their own problems and their own whatever, competitions and things like that. There was a rather stern father, and in many ways a harassed mother, I suppose, with 8 children and all kinds of nonsense going on. So I think it is perfect to get along with yourself, you know, and be quite happy with yourself. And so I enjoyed that. So I was always a little quieter, I think, than maybe normal. Everything was normal, running around and playing cricket and being fanatical and getting beaten for running out of the house quietly to play cricket. And so all of those things were going on. You know, this Anglo-Indian thing, I never ever understood what an Anglo-Indian was, other than other Angrej and other Hindustani. And growing up at the time, I was 8 years old when independence actually came. So, there was this very Angrej vatavaran in the house. This very Angreji kind of.
Chota Hajri, Bada Hajri.
Yes, that kind of thing. Bilkul. I grew up in the family, my father in his youth or whatever, at the beginning of the family, was the first coroner of color in India. So there was very gracious lives for my mother and him and very lovely homes and things. But by the time my kid sister and I came along, I think my father had had his own battles with life. And a very ethical gentleman, a very, this is the way that is right, and he do what is right. So I remember sort of hearing stories about what he did. You know, he was a big shot, changing his white silk suit 3 times in the day, kind of society doctor also, bedside manner, doing military hospital rounds, having his own practice. So father was never around kind of thing. And I lost my father when he moved on, passed away, and I was only 14 or 15. So I didn't get a long look at him. But I do have memories of my father just about sitting down to have a meal, and he's called away on some medical rush, and the spoon goes into the sugar bowl, and he's sort of like telling everybody never do anything on an empty stomach and taking a spoon of sugar, and out the door. You know, it's his bag and off he went. So, yes, the vatavaran in the house when we were growing up, my kid sister and I, showed that this house had a grandeur and glory at some point, but was in many ways struggling now, and but not in a way that it impacted on us. But as I say, as a small child, one was able to pick up on those things. Conversations at a dining table which you had no idea what was being talked about, but you put the pieces together in some quiet moment in a mulberry tree. What does this mean, you know?
So whenever you came down to dining table, you had to be dressed up properly?
Not so much dressed up, but yes, running around in the house in a banyan, was out of your room. You could be in your room, I suppose, naked even, but you couldn't move out of the privacy of your room into the public areas of the house without a shirt on. Because that used to stun me personally often, you know, when you get screamed that you're going for a glass of water or something, and you're unaware that you're in your singlet, you get a volley, not of abuse, but of chastisement. You know, what are you doing running around naked? And it used to stun me, you know, naked, and I used to really look to see if I was naked. But it was only that kind of thing.
Would you like to share that incident when your father chased you around the house and you kept on dodging him?
I mean, part of my father, as I said, was a very stern man, and for whatever reasons, you know, he had a very short temper. And I know that my elder brothers and all had felt the weight of an ex-rugby player's hand. My father was Juketa as
solid.
I think he was tired by the time it came around to perhaps my number, you know, to get lobbed around. But it never ever happened. My father never ever touched me once in my life. But he did make an attempt, yes.
What had you done?
I don't remember. Obviously nothing of any importance, you know, that it, what does a child do that makes an adult freak out or whatever?
It's an eternal mystery.
I hadn't stolen anything, I hadn't eaten out of turn or anything that I can remember. But I do remember this huge bed on which mother and father and a couple of kids would usually be asleep. Him chasing me around his bed for some reason, obviously to give me a duck. And I thought, no way, you know. I was, as a child, also a bit fragile that way, a bit of a sarangi wala, you know. I didn't like violence in any shape, form, or the other. Never in my life, I can claim, I have never in my life brawled, ever. Mm-hmm. One disastrous boxing tamasha. But that was all part of boxing. And so I was rather timid about those kind of things. And so father was chasing me around this bed.
And you ran?
And then I got cornered near the bed, on the other side of the bed. And there was this way and that way and everything else. And then he screams and says, "Stand there and take it like a man." And I just found myself, and when I look at pictures of myself, you know, how could you hit something? So, I was very pretty, you know. How can you hit a child?
Yes. A cherub, an angel.
Absolutely. Yes. And I remember that very clearly. I could not have been more than 7 or 8 or 9 or whatever it is. I said, "Are you mad? Stand there and take it like a man. Look at your size and look at my size. You know, who's going to lose here?" This whole dialogue.
You said that.
Oh, Mr. Philosophy came out, you know. I'm not going to, if you can catch me, it's the only thing I've got going for me. If you can catch me, catch me. But if you will not stand here and get hit. And my father had the temper that bucketed up and came straight down. I'll never forget that look on my father's face, which told me even then, and I recognized it then and to this day. I don't have to worry about this one too much. He's got the right end of the stick, you know, and he'll take care of himself. I distinctly had that feeling that it gave my father some pleasure. Maybe if I could not defend myself physically, my mouse would come to play. And that has helped a lot in life. So, I never again got chased. But I had a much worse situation to deal with. But after that, about then, anytime I asked my father for anything, permission to go somewhere, and he would always refer to my mother and say, "Speak to your mother about it." And I would beg and plead and do my best wakala thing. You know what she would say. She has only one word, no. But he used to sort of just not get engaged in the document. He would just ask your mother.
Once you mentioned about his disdain for a upcoming doctor in Allahabad, who was indulging in questionable practices.
Questionably, he was making money. I mean, it started very well. Look at the state of doctors today. You know, it's a money thing. You know, I don't know what is happening to whatever Hippocratic or whatever. What is that? An oath or something with the case. No, my father, and he was his jailer, sort of thing. But
this jailer was the Anglo?
Yes. And he used to refer his poorer patients down the road to Dr. Wakefield, strictly on, and again at a very young age, understanding, okay, this is what's going on kind of thing, send the patients over to Dr. Wakefield, who couldn't pay his fees. Actually, that gentleman, and he, that I learned from my brother Richard not so long ago, that he was basically not responsible for my father's death, but my father was taking some medication for some ailment that was enough to kill a horse. But my father had obviously self-medicated himself for so many years. He was a doctor. But this chap, when he discovered it, stopped it. And my father, I think, was too weak at that time to sort of like battle it. And I believe my father didn't live very long after that. But I do recall that when my father was dying, this man appeared in the doorway. I don't know how that fellow felt for the rest of his life, but I do recall my father looking at him and saying, "Get that man out." This doctor had to leave. So I always thought, I wouldn't like to be at the end of somebody's life being told by that person, get out of this room. It's a horrible indictment. Anyway, that was neither here nor there. Saying, life was very nice, you know, as I said, make believe. Even though mothers and fathers may have been having their own economic situations with their children or whatever it is, you know, then at important times like festivals and especially Christmas and things, I never ever felt that there was excitement, there was all of those things that a child gets off on, including getting presents and all kinds of madnesses. And paper chains going up and decorations happening. You can see the vatavaran in the house. That way, my mother and father got blessed from both. Were good.
There was a piano in your home?
Yes, yes.
And mother used to play when guests used to be around, or?
Oh, everybody, even those of us children who knew how to play two notes. That what used to be. I used to feel a little bit like in a circus. Yes, that I didn't mind, like very much. Come and play something, come and do something. And you can be back like now, the ponies have been trotted out and now the dancing bears are coming. And I didn't mind that part of life at all. I certainly liked the companion that that piano ended up being as one sort of was coming into ages of 12 and 13 and things and having all usual problems. The piano used to be.
So how did you learn it? I mean, did you learn mother, it from mother?
Yes. I don't know why out of there were five boys and three girls in the house. She took all of the girls through pretty advanced levels, especially my kid sister, who tragically doesn't touch the piano now, I hear. She's waited for a long time.
But she took Journey.
She took Journey all the way through to licentiate to teaching or something, which in Trinity College of Music. I think that's just about as far as you can go. But out of the boys, she decided that I would be the one that's going to learn. I didn't much care for that. I used to play by ear, you know, I used to play with the piano. I learned self-taught kind of thing to get a tune out.